Radio East Coast Commercial, testing on 6.90 in the 48-meter band shortwave. Our regular programming commences at 1100 hours UTC. This is a test transmission on 6.290 from Radio East Coast Commercial. FRS goes DX. FRS Goes DX is a monthly free radio publication covering many interesting aspects of unlicensed broadcasting and can be obtained on an annual subscription basis at the following rates. Within Europe, 21.50 German marks, 21.50 Dutch guilders, or £6.25 sterling. Outside Europe, FRS Goes DX will cost you $13. Payment can be made using either cash or euro checks. Any other sort of check will be accepted by FRS Goes DX, but the subscription cost must then include a 15% additional charge. A sample copy of FRS Goes DX can be obtained for either 3 international reply coupons, 4x80 or 8x40 Finning mint German stamps, 4x75 cent mint Dutch stamps, or £1 sterling in cash or mint UK stamps. The contact address for FRS Goes DX is PO Box 2727 6049ZG Pertem in Holland. Pertem is spelled Hotel Echo Romeo Tango Echo November. The free radio sheet. Can you reach that? Write this free radio sheet, and it contains free radio information with logs and news in the German language and from time to time also in English. The free radio sheet is printed every 2 to 3 weeks for readers in 7 countries. Details about this latest addition to the free radio bulletin can be obtained by writing to K. Richter, P.O. Box 3, D4602, Biesnitz in the German Democratic Republic. If you require information regarding the free radio sheet, write to K. Richter, P.O. Box 3, D4602, Biesnitz in the German Democratic Republic.
Two on WFRL, wonderful free radio London. That of course is the Lessons in Love. WFRL on the 48 meter band, broadcasting to Europe and the United Kingdom. Certainly hope that you're enjoying the programs today. Don't forget to keep tuned to WFRL. 11 o'clock of course is Tony Wolf. He'll be having hopefully some music that could be on your game card. And of course next weekend you've got Andy Walker and Ian Johnson and
a bus always slow on the short way with David DeRose.
This is International EMFM.
This is Radio East Coast Commercial testing. Our regular transmission commences at 1100 hours UTC.
I did mention at the beginning of the program that today I was playing the recording of a Scottish free radio station from 1973. Recording is actually an off-air recording. It's probably 20 miles away approximately from where the transmitter site used to be. It was a nighttime test transmission, this one was. And if you're getting good reception, you may hear sound interference in the background on the recording. This was Radio RAG, R-A-G, that was causing the interference. Radio RAG was a university station from the early 70s that popped up once or twice a year on RAG weeks. So, this station that we're going to play, we've got some pieces for you. The quality is not the best thing, but hopefully you will be able to make it out. Once again, this station is a Scottish free radio station, or it was. Recordings from 1973, it's not fair. The station's name was Radio Free Caroline on 229. This is broadcasting a cash transmission. The power they were using for this cash transmission, for the recording I'm going to play you, the power was about, I think it was 60 or 100 watts, into a Mazinga antenna. Well, this station actually began in 1966 up here in this coastal station. And I think it was about 1968 we changed their name to Radio Free Caroline. It was for the purpose of not letting people forget about Caroline. And I think we broadcast till 1974 or 75. Then we finally did go up there voluntarily. So, without any further ado, here's the recording of MLP, Caroline. Welcome to the Fair Position.
What do you think, Caroline? Back on the airwaves on 29.
Interesting to speak to you on the phone a couple of weeks ago. He said I'd see into Orion today, Sunday the 5th of November from 12.55 to 14.10 on 6299. The DJ was Bill Johnson of UK Radio. He says I remember listening to him on that station when they were on the shortwave in the early 80s.
Broadcasting on 6.290 in the 48 meter band shortwave, this is Free Radio from England, Radio East Coast Commercial. The mailing address for Radio East Coast Commercial is RECC PO Box number 5, Unstanton, Norfolk, PE 365AU in England. Everyone has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. This right includes freedom to hold opinions without interference and to seek, receive, and impart information and ideas through any media, regardless of frontiers. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the United Nations, 1948. Hello there, this is yours truly, Norman Nelson, with you once again on Radio East Coast Commercial. Hopefully you have found us on 6.290 today. Our new frequency for the time being, 6.290 in the 48 meter band. And let's wish for good reception for the next 3 hours or whatever. This is the first Sunday in the month, the first Sunday in the month of January 1990. It's the Big DX program from Radio East Coast Commercial. Contact addresses for the various things out of Ireland for the Scottish Free Radio Network. Contact address Stella is RSI 23 South Beechwood, Edinburgh, EH125YR in Scotland. And the contact address, there's two of them for Radio Marabou, either 01907435011DB Utrecht in Holland, or they can be contacted at the Bruchtal 22 West Germany address. And finally, out of Ireland, the address for Star International is SI221 Loose Rose, Maidstone, Kent, NE157DR in England. That completes our information out of Ireland for the moment.
And as was the case with Fragile Peace and MPLX Radio, we are in a, shall we say, an agreement or joint venture with them to do something. And, the Sarah could end up in Europe. It could end up just about anywhere on the face of the globe, because it is a ship and it can be moved here and there. So there are lots of possibilities with that. So you're saying that it might be leased out, and then that's one possibility.
It might be sold.
Anything can be sold. I don't want to say yes, it's going to be sold. I don't want to say yes, it's going to be leased. I'm saying that there are possibilities. People have contacted us on buying the ship. They have contacted us on leasing it. They have contacted us on entering into a joint venture. And And in the meantime, we have thought of entertaining these options because we are still in a legal dispute, which has a few more years to work out.
6275, 48 meters on a Sunday morning. That phone number has answered the phone. I'll probably be taking the calls live. Here on 01-291-2196. That's 01-291-2196. Now, there's been a few rumours flying about old Howard Rose taking, well, taking over Radio Caroline. It's a load of rubbish, obviously. Yes, the rumours were that Caroline was going to close in April and then go in with a leading person who has and this person was Howard. Well, it turns out, and thanks to my old pal, J.C., it's all total rumour and it's Howard on an ego trip, so, you know, if you're thinking of covering it on your radio station, don't worry about it. I mean, it's all a load of rubbish as per usual. It's WFRL 6275, 48 metre band. Let's have a bit more rock and roll, shall we? All right, here's the Olympics. Now, you can ring us up on 01-291-2196. That's 01-291-2196. Or alternatively, you can drop us a line at our mailing address. At the moment, it's 305 Stanton, Norfolk, PE36, 5OU in the United Kingdom. Now, old Ian Johnson, he's going to be yapping on about... Oh, there was a meeting last night. I'm not going to stand for that.
It's a music box that never stops. It's Happy Radio. Just turn it on and have it pop.
How do you spell it? How do you suppose they got all that sound in that little teeny box?
Radio makes my day happy.
It's a music box that never stops, and we love it so. As bright as cherry lollipops.
Happy Radio.
It's 11 o'clock. It's Ian Johnson. He's arrived here at the studio with Keith Archer carrying a video camera, would you believe? And Archer's just trying to put it together. I told him it was idiot proof, but he wouldn't believe me. Yes. Okay, don't forget that address. FRL P.O. Box number 5, Hunstanton, Norfolk, PE36, 5AU. Oh, alternatively, give us a ring on 01-291-2196. If you ring after 11 o'clock, you might be in luck. I might be answering the calls live. Okay, so ring up and swear down the phone, and I'll swear back, and we'll all have a good time. I'll say hello to Tom McClay and the rest of the Rainbow crew, Rainbow Germany over there in Germany. Good Morgan to you! Thanks for the Christmas card, or the postcard. Well, that's just about it. The penultimate Andy Walker Oldie show on the second Sunday. By the way, this is the Tornadoes and Globetrotter. Is it on your game card? It could be. So check it out. Hello to Pete, if he's listening. Sorry I haven't played the commercial, but things have been well hectic today. Well hectic. And what we last night, well, the less said, the better. Hello, Lisa, darling. Didn't we have a good time, eh? That's my partner. Okay, the time. 11 o'clock, standby for Ian Johnson. Tend to trip. This is WFRS. Passing on 6275 kilo. 48 metre band. I'm happy. Free radio today. I'll see you right here on WFL. From me, I'm out of here. Bye-bye.
Oops. Oops. Oops.
And my thanks to Andy Walker for the last hour. We
cancelled. So we'll be back next time around. And we've got a few more queues in the old game this time. I haven't got the faintest idea what they are. You probably know more about it than I do, but we'll have more of that a little bit later on. In the meantime, it's me, Ian Johnson, with you through until 12 o'clock today with the Tender Trip programme. And I think I should add that I'm being joined today once again by Keith Archer. And it's a pity this is not television, because if it were, I'd tell you up there right now, standing right behind me, because we're on television today, yes. This is the penultimate second Sunday of the Month programme, so we thought we'd get ourselves on television. So he's being cameraman at the moment, but he'll be with you in a very short while. In the meantime, how about we start off with some music, eh? And I'm damned if it's not a good time to have some band. Here we are. And the cart machines that are now there are a lot more reliable. A lot more jingles and promos are able to be played on the programmes, and things are pretty they were. Even a CD player in the studio now, so things really are looking quite professional, certainly compared to this place, anyway. The studio is certainly looking fairly homely now, and I think that it's almost back to its cosiness of before. I think we've mentioned before, but not just because we've taken this the last programme, the decks in the studio, in fact those that were originally overdrive service at the stern end of the ship where the old overdrive studios used to be. They were hidden away actually at the time of the raid on August the 19th, and they've been used to process as well. And they seem to be doing quite well for themselves. Stormy weather has caused a few problems over the last few weeks. They'll have better and more reliable equipment to be installed in the studio. It's not so much the studio where the action's been happening, because the majority of what's been going on has happened probably downstairs in the St. Peter Hall, where, in fact, Peter Chicago and Mike Dundee, the two engineers that have been on board over the last few months, have been busy working hard to get back to zero again. Now, the signal that you've been listening to, as I'm sure you have, on 558 kHz, is actually being radiated or transmitted by a combination of two of the old transmitters on board the ship. You may recall that there were actually three transmitters in the St. Peter Hall, 150 kilowatt amplifier transmitter and 210 kilowatt transmitters. Well, in fact, it's a combination of the shortwave transmitter on the port side of the ship and the former medium wave 819 transmitter, which are now putting the signal together using the remaining bits and pieces of both transmitters. We haven't worked too badly damaged. Peter has rather cleverly linked the two together and has managed to get one transmitter from two effectively. I'm told it's a pretty lethal combination, and those are novices, and I think Peter and Mike probably are the only two that know how it all works. Here to learn, but that doesn't really matter, I suppose, on board an offshore radio ship. That really matters. And the transmitter is only really putting the signal together about 1 kilowatt. In addition to the transmitter, of course, the aerial array is placed on the ground. The signal has been radiated by an aerial sprung between the new towers which were under construction at the time of the raid. The older towers were taken down, in fact, almost immediately after the raid. And the stern towers haven't quite been extended, so that we now have a system whereby there is 100 foot tower at the end of the ship and an 80 foot tower at the stern end of the ship. Between those two, an aerial system has been knocked up, and that's what was radiating the signal until fairly recently. But the good news is that over the Christmas period, the station managed to acquire some fairly hefty new output valves, which combined, there are five of them in total, and four of them are actually being used as part of the station, one is there. They've managed to allow the output to be put up to 5.5 kilowatts. So things are certainly looking a lot better than they were before. With the efficiency of the system being improved still further, the output is actually sounding quite good, and many people are actually reporting that the signal sounds almost as good as it was before all the cars work and the systems as well. There are one or two other plans as well produced, and these will see the stern tower extend to 120 feet by the addition of another 40 feet, in other words, another two sections of mast, and the forward tower has also extended by another 20 feet. There's one more section being put on there. Bring the whole lot up to the full height. Enable them to hang a much more sturdy aerial system between the two towers, and this will allow them to pump even more power up into the mast. Transmitters even now are running at a slightly lower power than they could do. The aerial system did cause a few problems a few days back, because you may be aware that last weekend, in fact, the station was off the air. Power signal was blasting into the aerial, but the strain injected, which had to hold the aerial in place at either end, where the aerial was attached to the mast, the power, pulling the station off the air. And so, higher quality strain injected had to then be installed, and that was in fact done, putting the station back on the air again. I think last Tuesday, if I remember rightly, they eventually came back on after time, Martin, Dave Acker and Carol Chicago. I think might be on board with the finally up and doing the necessary work. Bearing in mind, of course, it's not that easy to do that sort of work in the kind of sea conditions that there are on the North Sea. It's very windy, it's not easy to go working on aerials and things, but wait until that's possible. Anyway, it's certainly going to be very good indeed. Well, that's a brief view, Mayor, of what's been going on. We'll come back and take a little look at it more shortly, but it's 18 minutes past now here on 67.5, time for some more music, and bring in Keith Archer and you as well, and tell you one or two things about what we do, as well as what the offshore team's been playing at. Anyway, this is WSL on 67.5. Oh, do I really have to give them a moment?
Okay. You're in tune to 4IFR New Zealand, and we're coming to you via Radio Orion. And if you'd like to write to us at 4IFR New Zealand, you can write care of Radio Orion at Post Office Box 1280. In England, and we'll send you out our QSL card, our information sheet, and the company's some form of return postage, such as £1 or $1. Well, you're probably asking yourself, how do you write a reception report? Well, it's very simple. You get a bit of paper, you write your name.
However, behind the scenes, things were far from quiet. Former Radio Caroline DJ Paul Graham was well aware of the situation.
It was about 2 weeks before the actual incident, till the end of July, beginning of August. What actually happened was, we realised that several of the key figures within the organisation were actually being watched, or let's say the activities were being surveyed by other people. And then about a week before the actual incident, I might be wrong with some of my dates here, but basically what they did, they appeared at the office, the authorities, and said that, you know, that they were aware of our operations, etc., etc. And we realised then it was obviously going to be a problem. That was the first time we knew something was going to happen. But of course, we didn't know what.
Dave Richards takes up the story.
Our supply boat was late. Now, we've been suspecting supplies for quite a little while. Now, that made us suspect something might be happening. Of course, there had been action when another supply vessel was intercepted by the DCI and a police boat. Now, they actually stopped that particular operation, although they hadn't been arrested when they returned to port. Now, some weeks later, another one had been arranged, and we fully expected that to be there over the weekend before August the 14th. But obviously boats are late, so that didn't give us much reason to be sort of too concerned. August the 14th came and went, did our little bit at midnight, and we got to the Thursday when we were getting a little bit itchy, as you do when you're waiting for a boat. And on Friday morning, that was the time when the Landward turned up. Now, we realised, of course, when that approached us, that its intentions weren't exactly friendly. There were a couple of guys with video cameras and stills cameras. They came right up to the stern of the vessel, and we thought, well, they're hanging around, this is a bit strange. One move that they made, which was totally unprecedented, and it's the first time it's ever happened, even during the Euro siege business, was that they contacted us by radio. So of course we had to reply, and they asked permission to board the ship, which was of course refused, and they did comply with that, but they did say that the Caroline organisation had been busted. That was it. There was no more support for the station. But the Dutch operation, Radio 819, had been busted, 27 people arrested, which turned out later to be true, but of course the Caroline organisation, there had been inquiries, but...
On Friday the 18th of August, and he recalls how things did not quite sound right.
At about 20 to 11, Chris Kennedy took over from Nigel Harris, and then 10 minutes later, it appeared that things were perhaps not as they should be, by Chris Burr's Lady in Red and John Lennon's Imagine were played. Around 25 to 12, I heard Neil Gates state that Radio Caroline could also be heard on 819 as well as Park Highway from 12 o'clock. This, however, didn't take place until about half past 12. But after this, a few minutes later, an announcement was made by a Dutch disc jockey. I believe he was saying that Radio 819 was closing down due to problems with the Dutch studio.
Very good day. You're listening to Caroline on 558 and Radio 819 at 819.
The plane hung around all day. Negotiations went on. And we thought, well, it's probably time to call their bluff. And at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, it went out of our news bulletin. When it drew alongside. Now, we weren't quite sure what was going to happen at that point. Indeed, it was suspected that it could even be a tender. This massive yellow-coloured type came out of the distance. It was fairly bad visibility that day. The tender was in a very, very fast speed just around the back of a stern, and it maneuvered quite cleverly up to the side of the ship very, very quickly. There were, of course, a number of Dutch coast guards on board at the time. Those guys were armed. Some PCC officials from Holland. And basically, I suppose you call them labourers. Some contact the violence by VHF. Now, they totally ignored us. So it was at that stage Chicago decided to make a speech on air. Tried physically and quite passively to stop him coming aboard. It was at that stage that the Coast Guard struck Peter and knocked him back, hit his lip. The other armed Coast Guard behind him drew his gun, pointed that in the air. It was at that stage that all the hired hands tied the vessel up against the Ross, and at that stage all hell broke loose.
This is the registered Ross Revenge. Radio Caroline broadcasting from the international waters of the North Sea. It appears that we are now being boarded by a Dutch tug. We
are on Mayday distress call. By that time, Bruce was talking to the Dutch people to try and ascertain what was happening.
And one of the newsreaders was saying, hey, come over here, listen to this. This is the radio. And it was tuned in to Caroline 558. And all the appeals were going out for help, and we're about to be called. This isn't looking very good. And I had to go on the air at 1 o'clock. And this is all happening. So I thought, oh, dear. You know, I was a bit edgy. And on it went.
That was part one of a two-part documentary concerning the raid on board the Ross Revenge. Part two and the concluding part can be heard on BRI on Sunday the 25th of February at 10:00.
The Radio Broadcasting Library brings you the definitive story of the raid on the Ross Revenge. No man will ever forget Saturday, August the 19th, 1981.